I would like to acknowledge the Wurundjeri people, who are the traditional custodians of this land. I would also like to pay respect to the elders both past and present of the Kulin Nation, and extend that respect to other Indigenous Australians present.
Thanks. All right. Everything is clear there?
Or? Yes.
Okay, excellent. All right, so here I'm going to talk a bit about the general topic here is going to be knowledge representation, and more specifically, the path that it's taken me during my PhD, obviously with Simon's guidance and Hyung Wook as well, has been to kind of narrow things down towards finding what people call paradigmatic relations. So these are relations between words that occur in the same contexts, not at the same time, but they can be interchangeable in the same context. So for example, a cup of coffee can be transformed to a mug of coffee or the mug of coffee, and you still have the same general meaning, the same general sense. So there are certain words that you can interchange for one another, and these are often called paradigmatically related. And a lot of this work has been to find some of the psychological basically evidence for underlying psychological reality of paradigmatic relations, which has been tough, but I'll continue. I'll start by just briefly bringing up some of the earlier work that's been done in this realm. And I've essentially, you can think of them all as different forms of schema theory. So a schema is essentially a sort of template. It's a sort of, it's a structured representation for representing meaning, the meaning of, say, words. The general idea is that you assume that there's a surface level structure. So that's what the input is to the system, for example, a sentence. And then there are a set of rules, set of parsing rules that map this surface level representation to what has been known, called a deep structure. And this has been influenced greatly by Chomsky, his transformational grammar in the 50s. And there have been various forms of schema theories. So for example, the famous one is Collins and Quillian's semantic networks, where you have essentially concepts are represented as different nodes in the network and they're connected with labeled edges. So for example, the concept cat may be related to the concept animal through an is a relation. There could be other kinds of relations as well. There's been different instances of this as well. For instance, Minsky, his idea of frames, Shank and Abelson's notion of scripts, which are essentially sequential schema. I'll get into a more detailed definition of schema or schemata. We've also had proposition trees. So that's human associative memory, John Anderson and Bauer. And most recently, there's been proposition network. So that's been Kinch, who has essentially argued that you can capture all these different kinds of structures by just assuming a proposition schema. And a proposition is essentially just a predicate, which is stands for a relation. So for example, a verb could be a predicate. So loves, for example, and it takes several variables or it has several roles. For example, there is going to be a lover or an agent who does the loving, and then there's going to be a lovee or a patient who is loved. Basically, this propositional idea assumes that to understand the meaning of an utterance is to map the surface level structure to the predicate form or the propositional structure. So for example, you can think of a frame or a proposition as a function, which takes several arguments. So for example, loves with the agent filled to say John and the patient filled bound with Mary, for example. This is essentially called the role binding problem. That's the general general commonality between all these schema theories is that there's some kind of role binding going on. This has been this is you could think of this in a broader debate between the symbolic approaches and the connectionist approaches. And so, yeah, there's the famous Fodor and Polishin 88 paper that discusses this distinction. And the general idea here, and schema theories essentially are a kind of symbolic theory. They you could think of the, I mean, it gets a little more complicated because you can represent the symbols through distributed representations, in which case you have a kind of neurosymbolic framework. But overall, if you take the schema structure literally, you have a sort of symbol processing system. Which is what a term Newell suggested for any kind of system where you have role binding taking place. It essentially gives you enough computational power as a Turing machine or a a lambda calculus. With that aside, the general distinction here has been the symbolic approach is propositional or schematic, structured. It requires variable binding, it's rule based, and it essentially assumes a directed labeled graph. Whereas the connectionist approach, that's more linked to feature theories. In that case, it's spatial and it's statistical and similarity based, and you can essentially represent the knowledge. You assume that knowledge is represented in an unlabeled graph. That's the main difference that Fodor and Polishin also point out, is the idea of whether you have a labeled graph or an unlabeled graph. Having a labeled graph makes things a lot more complicated. It's difficult to train it. It's essentially much more computationally intractable, much less tractable. Than if you were to have non-labeled edges. There's been newer iterations of this sort of approach, and there's been a sort of synthesis between a symbolic and a neural, or which really stands for the idea of using distributed representations. And so Paul Smolensky has been spearheading a lot of this work in his tensor product systems. So in these systems, you essentially you represent individual words or the surface level items in your input. You represent those as vectors. So sort of like Beagle vectors, for example, or LSA vectors. And you also represent roles as the different vectors. And you can bind the roles with the items online using some kind of multiplicative operator like the convolution, for example. Or a tensor product, which is what Smolensky suggests, which is gives you less noisy performance. But the general problem with all of these approaches has been that they assume that the role representations are there a priori before any data, before the system has been trained on any data. They might assume the common kind of roles are, for example, agent roles or patient roles, or different actions, locations, and what have you. So this is a bit of a problem because, how do we know what roles are there in the first place, and how do they initially form? Are they are we assuming some kind of natalism here, It's hard to reconcile with some of the results showing how flexible these representations are during their emergence during various tasks. They're also very context dependent. So this is a bit of a problem, and so this is one of the this has been one of the general issues that I've been trying to address in my PhD using this DSP model. I'll explain that in a bit more detail later. But before that, I'll just kind of give you a more in-depth sort of demonstration of what it means to have a frame schema theoretic account. So if you have a sentence like it could take several weeks before the fire is completely extinguished, the idea is that as you see each of those words, you retrieve the related schema that, for example, it could leads to the retrieval of the possibility schema, which itself has several role fillers. It has variables. Those variables can be either bound to other the surface form, or they could be bound to other schemata that are retrieved. So in this case, possibility has the taking time schemata bound to its condition, and the putting out the fire bound to the possible event. And those are again can be unrolled to essentially show deeper structure for either further schemata or finally ending to some kind of leaf node where you get a final sort of concept. So for example, several or weeks. So this has been the general idea, and the theory is that to understand the meaning of a sentence is to understand all the schema that the sentence points to, and the way that the items within the sentence, the roles that they play within those schema. So, if those roles are explicitly filled through the surface form of the sentence, then that's great. If they're not filled, the system will fill them in itself through some kind of pattern completion process. You can think of certain frames essentially have, or schema having default variables, default values for their variables. So a cool example of this is this restaurant script that's commonly used. If I tell you that, yeah, well, I stopped by the Clyde for dinner, I don't really need to tell you that there was also a particular instance where I paid for the dinner, or I ordered the dinner, but the schema, that's all part of the schema. Despite me never mentioning those roles, the idea is that those roles were already filled by through some default variables, values. Now, what I want to argue here that links this to earlier work is that schemata are essentially just another kind of latent representation. And so you can think of this in a similar sense as, for example, Wörterbuch, where you have a set of input nodes and a set of output nodes, and you try to for and the input nodes, for example, will give you a context. So this could be just a localist representation where each element of the vector corresponds to a unique word, and then you feed that through to try to predict some item, for example, chased in this case. The idea, and this is also similar, this is a similar idea to say LSA topics and more recently the transformer models like BERT, where you essentially have stacks of layers which further compress the input to give you this latent representation. The general idea is that if we assume, for example, that you have some input domain that forms a set of nodes, and then you have a hidden domain. So that's up here. Those are the nodes up there. You can imagine that each of those nodes in the hidden layer have the receptive field, a sort of tuning curve over the input items. Now, in reality, they won't be this uniform because there won't be much structure, but you essentially have tuning. You can think of each hidden unit having a tuning curve or a receptive field. Now, the less of these you have, the broader those receptive fields have to be to try to capture all the data. So you get generalization this way through these models, these latent representation models. As you can think of the way the role of frames in a similar way, or schema in a similar way, in that they sort of you have a much larger set of features that are then mapped to this much smaller set, and through this mapping, you have the chance to get additional overlap between those items through that sort of compression, and so this is sort of get with the relational information aside, this idea of having a latent representation is very much similar at a broad lens, similar to the idea of schemata. But this is a bit of a problem because Simon Dennis has talked about this quite a bit. I talked about this in the previous talk as well. And the main problem is that with these latent representation systems, you need to have a lot of data to start capturing the semantic structure of the input domain. You also get catastrophic interference. So, for example, although you get more generalization as you compress your input through this smaller space, you also get a lot more interference that way. And it's pretty well known now that in neural networks that are trained with backpropagation, you essentially get catastrophic interference, which means that learning new associations can completely wipe out previously learned associations to a much greater extent than what we see in people. So these are some of the problems. Another issue, and here I want to demonstrate this in this room. The other issue is that we can learn the meaning of words very rapidly. So here's a sentence, for example: the wug had gray feathers. Right? People here have probably seen the word wug quite a lot more often than the average population, but you can kind of get the general meaning just by the linguistic context there. So, for example, if I asked you which one of these words wug is most similar to, and anyone want to just jump in and say what they think, or?
Eagle.
Eagle, exactly, right? Because through feathers, essentially, right? So that's pretty easy. But it really tells you that you don't need that many instances or samples of a given word in context to be able to start to infer its meaning. And so Lazaridou et al. Did something similar, and they showed essentially that it only took about two presentations. I'm sure you can, with certain contexts, if they're constraining enough, you could use a single presentation. But people could do this very rapidly. People can integrate new words meanings very rapidly. And if we also look, so here I just got a couple of estimates of the number of words, so vocabularies, that's V, that people might know, that people have been estimated to know at three different phases in three different age groups. And this isn't on a log scale. So around 2 years, people know around 200 words. By 6 to 10, it gets to around 6,900. And by the time they reach adulthood, they know around 50,000 word lemmas, actually. That's not quite, those are word, not the full word, but either way, what you see here, this is on a log scale. So essentially the number of words that people, the number of words people know grows exponentially in the first 18 years of development. And so this is one of the ways we've been trying to explain this effect has been basically rapid learning and integration of new words, one-shot learning, essentially, lack of catastrophic interference, and lack of a latent representation. So we've in a paper. So this is work I presented last talk. We modeled. We essentially assumed an associative net. And so for example, suppose that you've seen these three different strings in three different contexts, three different instances. So you've seen the eagle had white feathers, the hawk had black feathers, and wug had gray feathers. I've taken out the function words for just to simplify things. Now, if we assume that these are all stored in an associative net, Here, the label, the colors of the edges are just there for illustration purposes, so that the network doesn't necessarily distinguish between based on color. But I've just here; those are essentially the same color edges were learned in the same context. So one the thing I want to get across here was is that once you see the sentence that I showed you, WUG, we just assume it becomes associated with the words that it was seen with. So feathers and gray, right? Those are the first order associations. But if we think about the general network structure, WUG is also embedded within this broader configuration of nodes and edges. And so in a previous work where we modeled order independent associations, or what classically has been called synchronous association, essentially associations between items that are experienced simultaneously, we show that you can essentially rapidly, so if you queue the system with WUG and you spread activation across the edges, you can have a basis for inferring its meaning quite rapidly. So in the initially, so here I'm showing you the activation of different words just from a toy corpus, roughly corresponding to this structure. This is just a subset of the features there. What you get is the first order associate. So those are words like purple and feathers, which were directly experience with WUG. They are the most active, and they're the first to be active, but you also get these second order associations that are activated. So for example, white, black, eagle, and hawk. And so through this sort of network, the network dynamics of spreading activation gives us a way to explain the rapid word learning people are showing, and this might be a bit speculatory, but you might even be able to go further and say that the exponential growth in the number of words that people are learning has to do with essentially the exponential constraint that you get within a network of associations as you increase the information you have about the word by word co-occurrences there, or the concept co-occurrences. In that work, we also showed that with such a system, with such a mechanism, you can approximate the free association patterns of people more rapidly than popular models like WORTEVEC. So here I'm showing you that. On the left y-axis, I'm showing you the median rank. So, for example, a response by a given participant given a cue. So the lower the median rank, the closer the models match to the human free associates. So just to unpack that for, a bit. So in this task, people were in the free. So this is in the free association task. People are given individual words as cues, and they're asked to report the first word that comes to mind. And you do this over several subjects, and you can get the probability of a given response given each of the cues. Now we can look for each of the cues. We can look at the most probable response. So that's what we call the first associate. And then use that to test how closely the models that we have can match that data. So, and the way we do that is that we queue the model with the same cue that the people got, and then we look to see what the ranking is of the first associate in the activations of the model. So the higher up the rank, or the lower the number. So rank one is the best. That means that the model is getting the same first associate as people are, and the lower it is, the further the match. And so here, so that's shown on the left y-axis. On the right y-axis, this just shows the percent of times the first associate was also the most active when the model was queued with across all of the queues. And so what we see here is that in the dynamic EigenNet, which is a model that we proposed for spreading activation, you uh, you essentially approach asymptotic performance. So that's this dotted dashed curve in red. That's the median rank. So the lower that is, the better the match. You essentially reach the asymptote faster when you spread activation in an associative net with a model that we developed called the dynamic eigennet. And that's also that's in relation to Wojtyszek, which is a very commonly popular model in lexical modeling tasks. So we get better, we get faster learning if we spread activation in an associative net. So this was earlier work. That was the order independent associations. In an earlier paper, we also essentially used the dynamic eigennet to capture order dependent associations. So for example, A onto so for example, you know versus you is associated with a set of words that appear after it, and vice versa, a set of words that appear before it. In this work, what we showed was that if you spread activation with the dynamic eigennet, you're able to distinguish between bigrams that are either grammatical or ungrammatical. So for example, you know versus your no. Even if you go ahead and lesion the association between you and no. We essentially showed that you don't need a direct association between two items that occur sequentially to be able to tell that they're grammatical or not. So the system was generalizing. We also showed that in this sort of model, if we give people bigrams to discriminate of different types, so that we gave them different types of bigrams, each either had a essentially this was a two forced choice, two alternative forced choice tasks. You get a grammatical bigram on one side, ungrammatical on the other. Participants just respond as fast as possible which one is grammatical. And we compared our dynamic our associative net with two other models. So here on the left y-axis, I have the mean response time from participants. On the left on the right y-axis, I have the probability of correct. So probability correct corresponds to this blue line, and response time corresponds to the red line. And so we compared the dynamic eigennet, that's the lowest one, to two other associative nets. So the brain state in a box, which has been the sort of standard model, and the persistent linear associative net, which is a linear variant. And in both cases, we showed that using the dynamic eigennet, you get a much better prediction on both the response time and the accuracy using a discriminability signal derived straight from the network by cueing the network with either one of the bigrams and then essentially comparing the familiarities. But that was earlier work, and I don't want to talk too much about the modeling. Essentially, what that brings us, so we captured order-dependent and order-independent associations. But what we're really wanting to work towards is what are called paradigmatic associations. And so that gives us a completely opposite way to think about this idea of role binding. For example, take that same sentence I showed you earlier. It could take several weeks before so on. The syntagmatic paradigmatic account, this was initially proposed by de Saussure, who is a French linguist in the 1800s, late 1800s. And essentially he suggested that a lot of syntactic and semantic processing can be boiled down to the interaction between these two axes of variation in meaning. So on the one hand, you have the syntagmatic axis. So that is essentially sequential things that unroll in time. So A, B, and C. So sequentially ordered objects or items, essentially. And then you also have the paradigmatic, which is this sort of vertical axis, which gives you essentially a paradigmatic associates of each of the words that were sampled in that are sequentially ordered. So for example, this sentence would be your input, and you assume that for each of the words, so I haven't put all of them in. For so for example, several, you could also say many, you could say two, you could say 3 weeks, you could say months, years, hours, and so on. And you could capture a lot of this with the order information, the order dependent associations, right? So you could say, so if you have an order, serial order association between it, could, and take to many, you could get many activated in this bank, two, and so on. Essentially, the syntagmatic paradigmatic idea assumes that meaning can be decomposed into these two axes. And more recently, Simon Dennis has shown that if you have the right mechanism for capturing the intersection between these kinds of associations, you could actually approximate a lot of the same role binding that previous schema theories were trying to capture explicitly. This is also true of the neurosymbolic approaches, where they assume their roles a priori. They assume some kind of agent or patient role, and there's no learning of the roles going on. In this case, if you use paradigmatic associations instead, and you assume, for example, several is also bound to many, two, three, and other words that could be used interchangeably, that could sort of give you a continuous approximation of the role several. One thing I should mention here is that the role, so the same word, one of the difficulties here is that the same word could have different roles depending on the context, the broader sentential context. But using, if you assume the formation of these paradigmatic associations, that gives you a way to infer the role of each item online during processing, and I'll explain exactly how in the next few slides. But just starting out, initially we started looking for evidence, psychological evidence behind the SP model or the syntagmatic paradigmatic model, using this general idea. So this goes back to Simon's 2005 paper. So suppose you've learned four different sentences. I actually forgot to put the sentence, but you've studied essentially John loves Mary, Bert loves Ellen, Steve loves Jody, and Steve loves Jody. And then you're asked, who does Bert love? Ellen. That's been seen. So that's an example of, you know, what the recent GPT sort of lingo would call a one shot or a few shot learning. You kind of give it, you have a few examples of a question and an answer. So who does Bert love? Ellen. Who does Steve love? Jody. And then you ask the system, who does John love? Now, John, who does John love? The question form has not been seen in the system, but the system only has access to the explicit, the active form. John loves Mary. Simon Dennis showed that there, if using the syntagmatic paradigmatic account, you can actually get the system to provide the right answer, generally it does it in two processes. There are different ways you can get intersect syntagmatic and paradigmatic associations in this. I've been exploring a lot of them, but this is just one. So for example, you can assume that initially, who does John love? Basically, John occurs, and that's been associated with Mary. So that activates Mary through what's called a sequential here, or syntagmatic association. And you also get, based on just this general form of the sentence, which has been seen before, just that surface level alignment, you also get Ellen and Jody activated. So initially the system might be primed to say Ellen, but Ellen, if we assume this relational long-term memory, where you had Jody and Mary activated in this bank. If you assume that that in a the paradigmatic relations between those words further activate Mary, then Mary now gets to is activated not only through John based on the syntagmatic associations, but also through its paradigmatic relations with Ellen and Jody, and that bumps up Mary above Ellen and Jody, which don't have a syntagmatic association with John. So that was a general idea, and so that set me down essentially this path of finding psychological evidence for paradigmatic and syntagmatic associations, and this has been done. We did this essentially within the framework of interference theory. So in the release from proactive interference paradigm, for example, you see a set of words. You learn lists of words. For example, the first list might give you a set of words from a category like professions, and then you get another list that might again be professions, another set of words, not the same words, but all again the same category, and so forth. And performance goes down essentially after you learn each list, because of the idea has been that there's interference between those the representation of those items, and so that's basically the general framework we've been working under for trying to capture these kinds of relations. And so in the first set of studies that I ran, these I call these the narrative studies. Here we had people, we embedded these target sentences. So the target sentences here are the first sentence in each of these cells. So Ray chugged his beer, Jared wore his coat, so on. And then we also placed different lures corresponding to each of those targets. So Ray is the target here. We might have another word involving Ray, a hornet stung Ray. Actually, we for each of the conditions, we had the target play both in the active role and passive role of one other sentence. What we varied was that sometimes we added another lure, another name. So Brian, who was aligned syntagmatically with the target sentence. So the target was Jared wore his coat. And then the lure here could be Brian wore his glasses. So they both used the word wore. In that case, when later cued, participants would read these sentences and later be cued with something like who was the coat worn by, that the right answer is Jared. But worn was also associated with Brian syntagmatically. So there's overlap between Jared and Brian through a syntagmatic link in this cell. We could have the same kind of approach, same sort of idea, but paradigmatically. So Fred smelled a tulip. That would be the target. The question for that was who was the tulip smelled by? Right, there's no there's another lure here. It's a raccoon chased Eric. So there's no overlap syntagmatically between that lure and the cue, the question. So there's no syntagmatic associations, but there is this other sentence involving the target, essentially in using the target as being chased, as the chasee of the verb chased. So based on the paradigmatic theory, we would assume there's going to be a paradigmatic link between Fred and Eric, okay, due to them both having occurred in the same context as being chased. And then we also had this other condition where we had both kinds of overlap present. So the idea was that the hypothesis was that if people are forming these associations, then we should see greater interference when you have either paradigmatic, syntagmatic, or both kinds of overlap with the lures. So we use this structure over a series of narrative studies. Here I'm showing you results for four of those studies, and the general pattern was that we often get and actually, let me explain this here. So here we have the probability of correct for each of these four panels. Probability of correct as a function of whether there was or was not syntagmatic overlap between the target and the lure. The blue corresponds to the conditions where there wasn't any paradigmatic overlap, and then the red corresponds to conditions where there was paradigmatic overlap. And so what's really clear, I think, from these plots is that it's very reliable that you'll get syntagmatic interference, or you'll get interference based on syntagmatic overlap. And the thing is, that's not very surprising. So we've known that for some time. It's essentially a similar effect as the fanning effect that's been studied by John Anderson for some time. So that wasn't very, very interesting. What we really wanted to see was a distinction between the blue and the red here. We wanted to see lower performance when there was paradigmatic overlap relative to when there wasn't. And in the earlier narrative studies, we didn't quite get that. We didn't get very reliable effects for paradigmatic relations. And so that led us down to another series of studies, which here just naming them the pre-memorization studies. So we thought that maybe people were maybe our manipulation just wasn't quite as strong. They only had one chance to form this association. So what if we were to repeatedly have them learn these lists of sentences with paradigmatic relations iteratively, say in a pre-memorization task. And then then in a final critical session, in a recognition task at the end, we tested to see how confusable their memories were between targets and paradigmatically overlapping lures. So just to go over this briefly, I wasn't expecting this to go on this long. I'm just actually gonna go through these a little fast. So essentially what we did was we had a bunch of I'm gonna skip these and go to the more interesting results. So there we got, basically just to cut the story short, we got in that experiment, we got an effect for a paradigmatic overlap. Particularly people were had a higher false alarm rate when there was a paradigmatic lure relative to when there wasn't, but that had some issues. I'll skip these. So in a later experiment, essentially what we worried was that in that case, so you would have a paradigmatic lure basically testing the recognition for a sentence that was studied in the critical phase. So here, basically, they studied one list, then they were tested for it. They studied another list, they were tested for it. Did this iteratively, so there were two lists. Did this until they got all the answers correct, and then they went on to a final recognition phase. We imposed or induced paradigmatic overlap between targets and lures in the pre-memorization part. And then we would give subjects a new sentence to study in the critical part, and then compare their performance for that and a lure and a foil that was paradigmatically relative to another foil that was not paradigmatically related. What we worried about was that there could, so we got that increased probability of false alarm, but we worried that that might have been indirectly mediated through syntagmatic associations. So Eric, they would get the foil Eric ate an apple. Maybe that there was syntagmatic flow from those other words to the target. So in another experiment, we tested. We essentially reran that, and then but this time we only showed them the names as targets without any sentences. And in that one, we get messier results. Essentially, we get the effect in the response times, but not the probability of false alarms. So just essentially, this has been it's been messy to finding these. But the most recent set of experiments, what we did was we took out the critical phase with the recognition phase, and we just went with this task where you study a list, and then you get a closed set of closed questions for that list. You study another list, you get closed questions for that list, and so on. In one condition, the same context co-occurs. So first, in the first study, you have the dog chased Eric, and the second, you have the dog chased Henry. So Eric and Henry should be confusable. And then we basically, in the static condition, we just repeated that same structure. So then they get dog chased Eric again, and so on. Basically, we if they answer Eric to this test, that's correct. If they answer Henry to this one, that is considered a paradigmatic intrusion. We compare that to a dynamic context condition where, again, you have Eric and Henry being paradigmatically related, but every two lists, we swap the contexts. So now Eric and Henry are in the second pair of lists. Eric and Henry are again linked, but this time through the context, the remedy healed instead of the dog chased. And so what we wondered was, in the earlier studies, we were under the assumption that there was a direct paradigmatic association forming between two items, say Henry and Eric. But then we started to wonder, maybe this is essentially context reinstatement that's taking place. Maybe the paradigmatic association occurs online during retrieval based on the reinstatement of context. If that's the case, then swapping the context should wipe out interference. And so that's what we tested here. And I'll just quickly show you those results. And I won't show you the accuracy. There's no effect on accuracy. Essentially, the main dependent variable here has been the probability of a filler. And so a filler is essentially what we define, essentially like confusing Henry with Eric, for example. So out of all the errors, out of all the intra-list errors, so intra-list here is defined as if the participant reported another name that was studied instead of the correct name, that's an intra-list. And then we can narrow that down to fillers. So those were paradigmatically related intrusions. So we ran that study. Here we had 24 different lists. The blue condition, and we also have a random condition where the context changes every list. So there's essentially no room for there's no overlap forming between targets. So what you see here is the probability of a filler across each of the 24 closed tests. And so in the first instance, you don't have any chance to have a filler. Then as you continue on, what we saw is that in the static condition, that's when the context continues to, that's essentially repeated each time. You see this increase in the probability of filler. Whereas in the dynamic condition, that's in orange, you see this zigzag pattern that is indicative of essentially the release from interference every time you change the context. So this isn't predicted by the direct association account. This is essentially suggesting that context is reinstating online, and the paradigmatic relations form based on context reinstatement. And so if you get a clear picture if you separate the even and odd trials. So the odd trials, that's when you get a new context in the dynamic case, in the static case, again, you have the same context. You see this, as you see it very clearly. The dynamic condition, that's essentially not distinguishable from the random condition. I should mention this was the condition here was done between subjects. That's indistinguishable from the random condition. But if you look at the even trials, you get sort of similar interference between both the dynamic and static. And just to kind of show you another follow-up on that study we did, in the first one, the order associations were matched between study item and the close items. In the second one, we wondered, you know, maybe it's because of the direct associative information, direct serial order associations, maybe causing, you know, essentially giving a very inhibitory signal, imposing an inhibitory signal due to the mismatch when you switch the context in the dynamic condition. So in a follow-up, we mismatched the close, the word order in the close task with the original study items. Again, with the two kinds of condition, three kinds of conditions, we get more noisy results. But we essentially get the same pattern. We get the same kind of zigzagging going on. And again, if we separate them out, we see that there's quite a lot of noise actually in the even conditions. But the odd conditions, really, the odd trials, that's what really, I think that's the critical sort of test here. You see this again. Random and static, random and dynamic conditions are essentially indistinguishable, but you get this buildup of interference in the static condition. So this is suggesting that paradigmatic interference occurs as a function of context mediation during retrieval, not through a direct association at encoding. And I'll stop there.